Javi hoy nos acompaña, un componente especial, como les decíamos, que Tigo Uniform trae para todos ustedes. Para él pido un muy fuerte aplauso para él.
Whether it's the Internet of Things, AI, Big Data, Cloud, We as a nation in Colombia are not going to survive and be competitive. Colombia is in a very important point in history, from the peace to dissension to the OECD program. This is the time, and that's what I want to talk to you about. So I hope that the next 30 minutes or so, you stay with me, because I'm going to go through some data. It's important data that is meaningful and that's purposeful. So, in order for us to understand how the government and the industries can begin to help Colombia transform this country to lead the fourth industrial revolution, we first need to take a big, holistic perspective. So what you're seeing on the screen is a statement from this year's OECD report. And it's very interesting because it said, better, but not good enough. And the reason for that is historically, we haven't quite risen above that growth curve. We're still in that low growth track. That's less than 3%. Let us talk about Colombia. This report is from the early part of this year. The Colombia economy has been quite resilient, given the fact that it's gone through some significant commodity price collapse, as most of you are aware. Now, however, though it's relatively done better than some of your Latin American neighbors, it actually, still relatively speaking, as a percentage, in terms of change of year over year, it's still fairly low. So what does low look like? You may not be able to see this chart in detail, but this year, the GDP is expected to be 2.2%, and next year, GDP is going to grow to 3%. That is slow. That is modest. And here's what OECD Director of Country Studies, Alvarez Pereira, said. The challenge going forward is to deliver higher income and well-being for all Colombians. The peace agreement will certainly boost certain sectors and create jobs, such as agriculture, buildings, and civil works. But we need to make sure that this growth is inclusive, that all the regions, all the people are taking advantage of this growth. More importantly, we need to achieve better educational outcomes and to bring more people into the formal economy, as well as to invest in infrastructure that is fundamental to the fourth industrial revolution. Now let's talk about the exchange rate. As the figure shows, the depreciation of the exchange rate has been significant and has been putting a tremendous amount of pressure on prices. Let's talk about the value of exports. Since 2015, there has been a significant fall in exports. A lot of it has to be driven by oil exports in particular. But it shows the vulnerability of Colombia as a country to commodity prices and global markets. Now that has translated to steep drop in government oil revenue, right? Now I emphasize, again, the vulnerability of Colombia to market fluctuations in the oil commodity prices. So what do we need? How do we provide sustainable economic growth for Colombia? And what are some structural issues that is limiting Colombia as a country to move forward? Well, first one is low skills that are holding back productivity, right? The limited access to high quality education, which then results in lower productivity and increases in income inequality. Now, I was talking to somebody earlier today. There are some great private colleges and universities in Colombia, and a couple of great public universities. But what about everybody else who can't afford that kind of tuition? Where are they supposed to obtain higher education around technology, science, mathematics? Now, of course, the government has implemented many programs since 2015 or so in terms of expanding school coverage, better training, with working in conjunction with industries. But more is needed. We need to further strengthen the human capital. Going to the example I gave around South Korea, it was all around human capital. In the 70s, we went out to the world and recruited the best professors to come to Korea and to teach. And now we have one of the best universities in the world. And it's all about human capital and rigor. Let's move on to the next fundamental structure issue, which is around infrastructure that increases transportation costs. Infrastructure gaps continue to remain large. That's constraining productivity growth. And it's contributing to wide regional disparities and higher transportation costs. I was pleased to hear that in certain parts of Colombia, there's been improved transportation, some of the best metros, and some of the best systems that allow us to go to high altitude and remote areas, for example. But we need more. More importantly, we need greater competition as needed in certain sectors, such as rail, oil and gas, electricity, and roads. And we even have our telcos today in terms of the regulatory environment that they're in. Now, most of you are familiar with the fourth generation or the 4G road concessions that are underway. And this is great, and this is a great start. But again, we need more to foster beyond just agriculture and regional development to national sustainable economic growth. Let's talk about the third category. Innovation is relatively weak because of low investments in R&D and poor business sector and academia collaboration. So Colombian firms as an industry tends to invest relatively little in innovation. And they're missing out on the important productivity. I can tell you that other countries, it's about patents and IP, and they're driving innovation because they know innovation is a fundamental engine to transforming a country. But let's look at the numbers. R&D expenditures are less than 0.2% of GDP. In comparison to 20% on average spent by OECD nations. Only a small portion of manufacturing firms introduce new products. Only 30% of total R&D is performed by the business sector, whereas compare that to 70% of other OECD nations around the world. And why does this work? Better innovation policies are needed to support knowledge-based capital. Capital by itself is neutral, but when take capital and infuse it with IP and intellectual property, it becomes powerful. It drives productivity, it drives competitiveness, and it needs to support R&D, particularly around enterprises, and fund those R&D projects to bring industry and academia together. Lastly, is around firm competitiveness. Like I said before, there are regulatory burdens and slow judicial outcomes. So we need to think about how do we start to systematically remove some of these regulations on public ownership or vertical integration of electricity and rail, as well as to introduce division of the courts that dedicated to commercial cases. That also simplifies legal procedures to support private investments and to move Colombia towards a greater productivity. Again, it's about how do we increase the value chain, the value add to adopt frontier technologies. Let's drill down. Now, when comparing income inequality across countries, Colombia is actually on the higher, what they call the Gini index, which is a measurement for income inequality. Now, I've heard from some of you today that you want to bolster the middle class. You want to spread the wealth. Well, how do we start to do that? How do we strip around the wealth to other regions and other rural regions in particular? Student performance. In terms of math, science, and reading, Columbia is lower in a measurement called PISA scores, not only in OECD, but also in Latin countries, such as Chile, Mexico, and Brazil. Another fact around human capital is around minimum wage. The relative high minimum wage to OECD nations discouraged young people from pursuing formal college education. So we need to think about all these policies that works to incent, to educate, and to empower the youth and the labor force of tomorrow. Specific to student performance in sciences, Columbia has one of the lowest PISA scores. And you can see that on the chart, it's showing that much more annual growth can be had if human capital had a higher degree of universal skills, meaning skills that could be used just about anywhere in the world. So again, emphasis on education. Now, closely correlated to human capital and education is innovation. Columbia ranks last in terms of percentage of firms introducing new products to market to manufacturing. Columbia also needs to think about how for better innovation policies with improvements on the educational system to create a knowledge-based economy. Now, like I said before, market expenditures is low at 0.2%. This is not sustainable to creating a healthy, vibrant economy. Now, as a percentage, the company is working with academia and research institutions as well, because that's one of the key ingredients to building IP and commercializing. Specifically, less than 8% of manufacturing SMEs are participating, and less than 20% of larger enterprises are working with academia. That means that the potential game-changing technology around AI, quantum computing, blockchain, cybersecurity, and so forth are not being exploited and commercialized in Columbia. Infrastructure is perfect. Shipping costs, in particularly, if you look at the ranking, it's low on the quality of infrastructure. Columbia is a very interesting and important geolocation, and it has an opportunity to connect the rest of Central and South America and North America. So infrastructure and investment infrastructure is incredibly important. Now, this chart is showing the restrictive business regulation. What you're seeing is that the triangle that you see on the screen represents Columbia relative to the OECD average, which is represented by the red bars. Now, the higher the number, the more restrictive the regulation is. The state control is at above or at or above OECD average in terms of restrictions. In terms of barriers for entrepreneurship, again, it's at or above the average in most categories. And lastly, much higher barriers in terms of trade and investments. Now, relative to other nations, Columbia ranks high on the level of restrictive regulations for specifically electricity, transportation, and railroad sectors. Now, hopefully everything I'm telling you isn't something new. These are things that you're already aware of, and certainly these are not my opinions. But the point is that Columbia is doing great, but the opportunity ahead is much greater. So let's talk about disruption. Are you ready for disruption? To make the Columbia environment worse, there is exponential technologies that's about to decimate just about every current industries and the countries within. And according to Ernst & Young, they get down to 45% of companies in any industry, in any given point, will become obsolete in the next 2 years. Perhaps the biggest threat is coming from AI and robotics revolution, which is currently underway, very much so. A recent study by Oxford University and McKinsey and PwC forecasts that up to 50% of current jobs could be replaced by smart machines in the next 20 years or less. And already more than 5 million US factory jobs have been lost to automation since 2000. So without active government support and investment that's intentional in new technologies and job training by industry, we're going to find that Colombia is going to be left far behind by other countries and global firms that are leaner, more productive, more automated. So this brings us to Industry 4.0. So what makes the fourth industrial revolution? According to McKinsey, there is a short list of some, not a complete list, but a short list of disruptive technologies that's going to shape and reshape human societies and industries. From mobility, automation, particular AI, to Internet of Things, cloud computing, advanced robotics, autonomous vehicles, next-gen genomics, to energy storage, 3D printing, advanced materials like nanotechnology and graphene, to renewable energy. But that's just the beginning. The rhetoric, the terminology that we're sharing today, that's just the beginning. And I am telling you, I see what's coming down the next 10, 20 years. And it is mind-boggling. Nuclear fusion. Intergalactic travel. Brain-computer interface. The next several years will usher in incredible leap in innovation and technology that we can't even begin to fully comprehend or even begin to predict. Like I mentioned, quantum computing, quantum cybersecurity and teleportation, nanotechnology, in particular graphene and the properties of graphene to do just about all kinds of things, to the nuclear fusion that I mentioned. The message is clear. As we speak, the rest of the world is racing ahead with high-tech and higher-margin businesses driven by innovation. Nations like Colombia that stay with commodity products and services will find their margins shrinking and eventually displaced by renewable energy, robots, and automation. And that's why Amex Plus, Amex Venture, strategically works with nations to help transform nations, to move up the value of the chain and to lead to leapfrog technologies to help industries and the local economic region to adopt the fourth industrial revolution. So this brings us to the Internet of Things. According to the World Economic Forum, we predict that IoT is going to usher in the fourth industrial revolution. And of course, depending on who you talk to, analysts forecast anywhere from 34 to 50 billion devices connected by 2020, which is 3 years away or less. Now, in economic terms, that turns out to be $6 trillion USD spent on IoT solutions over the next 5 years. As a matter of fact, there's a new report that shows that 70%+ of industries and companies are starting to think and actively pursue IoT. That's the rest of the world. There are many reasons for adopting IoT, or Internet of Things. One is lowering the operating costs. Two is increasing productivity. And lastly is expanding to new markets and developing new product offerings. Because what I can tell you is that if you're a product manufacturer, tomorrow you're going to be a data as a service company. What you're seeing is a Portis 5 forces analysis on the screen. Now there's a lot of moving parts in terms of the industry relative to IoT, and with many threats to coming from suppliers, new entrants to substitute products. But the biggest threat that's coming from global competitors is that they're racing ahead to create differentiated products and do it in a way that's more profitable and creating new business models in the process. So it's becoming hyper-competitive from a global ecosystem, and it's driven by investment in technology. Now let's talk about the market potential. We know that businesses are the top adopters of IoT, and some 11.2 billion devices will be installed. Everything from water, agriculture, trains, city streets, buildings and manufacturing to our homes and cars will be IoT. Gartner predicts that more than 50% of all new business processes are going to rely on IoT. Industrial IoT offers businesses incredible wealth of insights and real-time insights that wasn't there before, that allows them to be able to reduce accidents in the case of coal mining, or fix problems like in machinery before it happens, or to increase efficiency, or to open up new areas of revenue. What you're seeing is the IoT market segmentation across the B2B and B2C, and it's touching just about every industry. That's the thing that's amazing, is IoT is not specific to just heavy industries and manufacturing. It cuts across engineering, automotive industry, to even advertising and marketing. And for those of you that are not technical, I try to give you something that's high level here from architecture. So let's start from the bottom and work our way up to the top. At the bottom level, we have the embedded devices and the objects. Those then communicate with each other and send that data via the gateway to the internet using various connectivity standards and protocols. And once that data is in the cloud, it's processed and then analyzed for insights, and some of which becomes available to users in the form of data visualization and reports. Now keep in mind, in addition to cloud, we're also seeing a movement towards decentralization or decentralized computing era, where the analytics is also occurring on the edge device before it even comes to the cloud. So it's becoming a spectrum. You have cloud and decentralized working in conjunction. Let's talk about standards and protocols. In the Internet of Things, the biggest challenge is around interoperability. We have to deal with many standard protocols. There's different packet size, different energy requirements, different distances, and different standards. Then it becomes very challenging to figure out what are you better on, or do you provide a multi-standard approach? Now let's look at the IoT landscape. You can see that it's becoming highly active, and already we're starting to see multi-billion dollar startups being created in IoT categories. Not just with large players like that you're seeing here, across infrastructure, API services, cloud services, platforms and hardware, but also the startups. And this is an older slide, but I can tell you that the startup ecosystem is becoming massively active, from smart buildings, smart cities, to data analytics and AI. Now let's talk about IoT use cases. As you're thinking, how does this actually apply to my business, my industry? So the first use case I'm going to cover is oil and gas. The face of the new norm of the oil and gas industry, of course, is the prices. Now there's recently the offshore, they're starting to see a bit of a rebound, but overall oil is somewhat disruptive. And IoT is central for that sector's survival. It starts first with being very clear about business objectives. What are they trying to achieve? What type of new information are they trying to access? And where are the bottlenecks that's limiting the flow of information? I'm going to break it into three categories. One is upstream. Upstream players focus on how optimization can gain new operational insights by standardizing the aggregated physics and non-physics data, then running that integrated analytics across functions of exploration, development, and production. Let's talk about midstream. The Michigan players are targeting how their hired network and new commercial opportunities can benefit by investing in sensors that touch just every aspect of their facilities and then analyzing the volume of data more comprehensively all along that network. And lastly, the downstream. The downstream, they're interested in understanding the entire ecosystem level so they can create new value by expanding their visibility into the complete hydrocarbon supply. To enhance that core refining economics and to target new digital consumers to new homes in the market. Let's move on to coal mining. As the population grows, we know that there is going to be increased pressure on the mining industry. Currently, 3.11 million pounds of minerals and fuels are required for each person in their lifetime. That's a lot. So the expectation of the next decade is that IoT will be used throughout the trade, whether we're talking about coal or any other minerals. The major benefit of IoT in this sector, of course, is significant improvement in performance and productivity. For example, eliminating costs and waste, and being able to anticipate machinery failures before it actually happens. And when it comes to developing or maintaining mine sites, IoT also helps dramatically plan things out and to reduce and mitigate risk. Now, once data starts to be collected, it's very interesting because now you start to understand what's happening and understand the risk level as well. So that means that before a collapse happens and people die in coal mining, the sensors can actually pick up real data, predict potential faulty infrastructure or equipment before it actually happens, or in some cases, proactively handle emergency planning before people get trapped. There's also the fully data integrated network that allows for them to monitor every aspect of the operation before things wear down and break down. Because when a machinery breaks down, that's productivity that's stalled. Let's talk about manufacturing overall. It's broad, but what we're talking about is the ability to support asset tracking, so you can track inventory and materials over time. It provides a predictive maintenance to avoid costly shutdowns. It gives real-time assets monitoring. And all of this supports real-time KPIs from connected operation intelligence for every asset of your downstream. Now, IoT is not a perfect solution. It is not the shiny bullet that solves our problems. It also has some challenges. And that's why it's important to work with the right partners, like a telco, like a strategy firm, that understand IoT in terms of some of the challenges and issues when it comes to implementing IoT properly, such as security, connectivity, compatibility, as well as the standards and data analytics issues. But let's briefly talk about security. The problem here is that from an incentive structure, the sensor manufacturer, the device manufacturers, they're not incented to always embed the most stringent SoC chips or the firmware security level because that's not where they make the money. So we get these devices and they're not as secure. But it starts with a general policy, a security policy. It needs to be holistic. Now, if you're thinking that the traditional security best practices apply, it does and it doesn't. Because IoT is fundamentally different in that it's not session space, meaning that you don't just take the phone and then put it down later, or turn on my internet website and then shut it down. But rather, it is constant on. It's a public subscribe, which means that it's susceptible to playback attack and potential over-the-air update security breaches. What about connectivity issues? As it grows, this centralized computing model, particularly the cloud, starts to get a little bit of a bottleneck, as well as become somewhat less cost-effective in the long run to send everything to the cloud, just one thing. So it requires a combination of what the cloud plus decentralized solutions that works on a mesh network, on an edge or cloud basis for edge processing and analytics to be able to balance out the workload and the data. Compatibility and longevity. They're trying to overcome, like I said, interoperability issues, because they're not sure, out of all these numerous standards and protocols, which ones to actually bet on. So you have to go to support or potentially multiple. And there's a short list of standards and protocols that you can see here. And lastly, intelligent analysis. The last several years around IoT has been around just getting the data, grabbing that data, right? Transforming it, processing it. But the real value of data, IoT, is about analytics. Now, looking at the historical trends and statistics is helpful, no doubt. But we need to move towards more deep learning and neural networks driven predictive analytics, which says, if these conditions continue, is there a potential for fire? Is there a potential for mining collapse, as an example? So predicted. And then the next level of maturity is going to be prescriptive, where you have a specific business goal to cut costs or to increase revenue. And you start to figure out all the different ways to optimize the value chain to achieve that goal. So if some of you are thinking that what I'm talking about is somewhere in the distance, 10 years away, 20 years away, it is not true. What I'm talking about is happening now. And it's happening aggressively in the US and Europe and Asia. Matter of fact, your customers are expecting IoT products and solutions. Your international customers. They're going to demand it. I was just in the Czech Republic, in Prague. Germany, which is one of their key strategic partners that drives their country's GDP, are demanding fourth industrial revolution compliant OEMs and suppliers. If you don't comply, you're not going to compete. More importantly, your competitors are aggressively going after IoT in order to capture market share and to create product differentiation. Now, this is probably the number one reason why we're hearing companies adopting IoT, because they need to stay at least at parity with the competitors. Your executives are wanting leaner, lower cost structure to protect their profit margins. Your shareholders and your board of directors want to see new growth areas and new products. And you have new competitors coming in from all directions. From non-traditional, like the Tesla, the SolarCities, the new startups that are coming in and just about taking away all sorts of your market share. In the US and Europe and Asia, we're going through something called a retail disruption, where real estate developers, shopping malls, retail stores, distribution channels, they're being completely disrupted. Not just because of Amazon, but because of capital structure, because of changes in behavior. And the things that they did incrementally wasn't good enough, and now they're facing bankruptcy. Moody's has about 22 and growing lists of companies that they're watching for bankruptcy. Nordstrom is at the brink of bankruptcy, and they're trying to go private, but that's stalling and failing as well. The time that we're in is incredibly disruptive. It is no longer a time for do nothing and wait, especially for those of you in manufacturing, oil and gas, where you have a commodity business. Robotics, automation, foreign competitors are going to be eating away at your base. The time is now to actively investigate the business case for the internet banks. Don't wait. Thank you.
Directamente su intervención más pregunta del público que están haciendo a través de la aplicación. La pregunta es, ¿el modelo de audio
universidad que hemos tenido hasta ahora es el mismo que necesitaremos en el futuro, o quizás necesitamos innovación en la educación para cerrar la brecha que el 4G requiere.
So one of the things that's happening around the world is educational reform that we've never seen before. The education of tomorrow is not going to be teacher-led, it's going to be student-led. And it's very much teachers playing the role of mentors and coaches. But more importantly, let me share a model in Israel. In Israel, they're very concerned about, like I said, I think somewhere in an early session, the top 2,000 students. So, one of the approaches that they have is early on in the K-12, before the age of 12, they work on specific facets of their cognitive functions: arts, science, mathematics, and technology. And there are certain exercises that they do to intentionally build out those facets of your mental abilities. And when they reach age 13, what they then do is they go to a specialized school where they now specialize in technology and science, including working on programming and technologies for 10 to 12 hours a day. It's intense. So by the time they come out of age 18, they have not only finished college, in many cases, they have already created startups and have collaborated with industries and created game-changing technologies. And this is exactly why Israel, as an example, is attracting so many technologies. They're not interested in innovation, they're interested in invention. They're working on exponential technologies that's going to replace. So as I said before, from Intel to Samsung to many companies around the world are actively going to Israel on almost a weekly basis to acquire these startups that are bringing incredible technologies for autonomous vehicles as well as for AI. That's what we need to do. The traditional way of teaching is not working. Coming from Czech Republic, like I said before, they're also rethinking their paradigm. And it's difficult to change that kind of entrenched model, so they're hacking it. Meaning, they realize that in a public school, in a K-12, there's about 7 minutes that they have in between classes. Well, now they're letting the kids play specific games for 7 minutes that's building up, like I said, math, science, art, and technology. And then there are schools actually being developed to send as camps to help reinforce the science, technology, and mathematics. Now, it's not just hard STEM that's needed. Education also requires attitude and mindset changes. Part of the problem that we have to create is the notion of failure. The young people don't want to go into startups because they think that if they fail, it's a reflection on them as a person. When in fact, if you go to Silicon Valley and you fail, they celebrate, they applaud, they say, great job for failing. Because they know that that is the fundamental building block to the next success. So the mindset, when I go to Central Eastern Europe, because they come from a communist background, what they have is good enough. They're satisfied, they don't need more. They don't have ambitions about the country. So they are somewhat lackadaisical. So it's the attitude and the mindset that we need to change the narrative and storytelling. So education is more than just the science, technology, and mathematics. It's about changing culture. It's about what you teach your kids about.
Muchísimas gracias, Scott, por tu